In this video, we will look at the infamous Higgs field. This is the field proposed by Peter Higgs in 1964 as part of the Higgs mechanism, which we discussed in the previous video. The Higgs field is the field associated with the Higgs boson, the particle responsible for giving masses to all fermions of the standard model. While the Higgs field and boson was proposed in 1964 and in the following years became a cornerstone of the standard model, it took almost half a century to discover this particle. One of the reasons is that the Higgs particle is one of the heaviest fundamental particles we know about, at a mass of 125 GeV, only surpassed by the mass of the top quark at 173 GeV. The heavier the particle is, the more energy is required to find it. But there can also be other reasons why particles can be hard to discover. Making experiments with higher energies require bigger machines, and so far only one such machine, namely the Large Hadron Collider LHC at CERN in Geneva, is able to produce it. It is also the place where the discovery was announced in 2012 after 48 years since the Higgs boson was first hypothesized. Why is the Higgs boson so important? We discussed the importance of the Higgs field in relation to the Higgs mechanism, which is part of the electroweak theory that explains why the weak force bosons have mass and why the photon is massless. But the question still remains, why do the fermion have mass? If we look at the standard model, we see that all the quarks and leptons are massive. In a similar way to Gauge boson not being allowed to be massive, we also can't just add masses to the fermions. When I say fermions, I refer to the quarks and leptons include particles like the electron and neutrinos. The issue is similar to that of the Gauge bosons. The symmetry group of the standard model simply prohibits us from writing a mass term like in the Lagrangian of QED or like in the Dirac equation. In QED it works because we have a simpler symmetry group, but for the standard model we cannot just write a mass term. Thus, without some clever mechanism, all particles of the standard model would be massless. This is what we will discuss more in this video. In the previous video, we discussed the Higgs mechanism, but let us just do a short recap. If you want more information, check out the previous video. The Higgs mechanism is when the Higgs potential changes into the infamous Misconceptions potential at a temperature below 160 GeV. This potential has two minima away from the origin, and the Higgs field drops into these new minima, so to say. The important part is that the x-axis represents the vacuum expectation value, or VEV. This we write with the letter V. When the Higgs field drops into this minima, the VEV becomes non-zero and obtains a value of 246 GeV, and the Higgs mass is written as mass of Higgs is equal to the square root of 2 lambda times V, where mh is the Higgs mass, lambda is the coupling constant, and then we have the VEV V. Thus, when the Higgs drops down into the minima and the vacuum expectation value becomes non-zero, then the mass of the Higgs also becomes non-zero. This process is called symmetry breaking, and this explains how the weak bosons obtain their mass too, as discussed in the video about electroweak theory. But for the purpose of this video, the important part is that this potential and symmetry breaking gives us a massive Higgs boson with a mass of 125 GeV and a non-zero VEV at 246 GeV. So now we have discussed how the Higgs boson and the W minus W plus and C bosons become massive. What about all the fermions? How do quarks and electrons become massive, and why is it important? Technically, the quarks are bound to each other via the strong force, so their mass is not so important. What would be the big issue is if the electron was massless. because then it would have a big impact on atoms and they wouldn't exist as we know them. The reason why these particles all have masses is due to their interaction with the Higgs field. All massive particles interact with the Higgs field and obtain their mass from that. Thus, the massless photons and gluons do not interact with the Higgs field, and therefore there is no Feynman diagram vertex that connects these particles to the Higgs boson. The intuitive explanation to how these particles become massive would be the analogy of a press room. Imagine a full room of press people waiting to interview, take pictures and film some famous people. Suppose some very famous person, like the queen of some country, comes into the press room. Everyone wants to interact with the queen, so she's very much obstructed by the press people on her path through the room. The press people are in this case acting like the Higgs field, slowing down the free movement of the queen. We know mass is the resistance to movement, thus this slowing down is exactly how mass is generated. Thus the queen in this case would correspond to a very heavy particle like the top quark, which heavily interacts with the Higgs field. Now suppose some lesser known person enters the press room. A few people will recognize this person, and therefore there won't be many people stopping this person from passing through the room. And thus this person corresponds to a lighter particle, like the electron or maybe the up quark. In this analogous way, the mass of all massive particles depend on how much they interact with the Higgs field. Note that in the classic standard model, neutrinos are massless, which is only approximately correct. Having discussed what intuitively happens, we can go into more technical details. What we write in terms of the Lagrangian of the standard model in order to achieve these masses with the Higgs field is three terms of the following shape. L is equal to minus q bar L prime times y d times phi times dr prime. And there are two more similar terms. The term shown here is the term for the down-type quarks, thus the down, strange and bottom quark. There is a term just like this for the up-type quarks, thus the up, charm and top quark, and then there's another term for the leptons. These three terms are all similar, so looking at one of the terms is enough to understand the concept. First we have these Q and D terms. These represent the quarks, or generally the fermions. Then we have this Y term, which is the Yukawa couplings that couples the quark to the Higgs field. The phi is then the Higgs field. So when we insert the Higgs field in its massive state from the Mexican head potential into this, then via the Yukawa coupling, the different quarks obtain the different masses. Now, a common misconception is that since the Higgs field and the Higgs mechanism is what gives masses to all fundamental particles, then you might think that the Higgs boson is the origin of all mass. This is not true. Yes, all fundamental particles of the standard model are massless without the Higgs field, and at the end of the day, these particles are what make up humans and planet Earth. But if you look at the mass of a proton, which is in the nucleus of an atom, and compare the proton mass to the mass of the constituent particles, thus two up quarks and a down quark, then you see that the quarks only make up around 1% of the proton mass. Thus almost all of the mass of an atom does not come from the fundamental particles, but from the energy of the quark-gluon interactions in the proton. This is because these interactions are very energetic, and using Einstein's famous equation E equals to mc squared, most of the mass comes from this energy and not from the quark masses. This video should hopefully have taught you the importance of the Higgs boson and how it leads to the fundamental mass of the particles of the standard model. You also now know that most of the mass in the universe is actually not from the Higgs, but due to E equals to mc squared, as this is the main contribution to the mass of atoms. The Higgs boson was very hard to discover due to the fact that it's quite massive and not so easy to detect. But after almost half a decade we found it, and this was a big milestone for the standard model and our understanding of fundamental physics. If you like this video, please consider supporting the channel using the link in the description. As always, I hope you learned something new, and if you have any questions, please put them in the comments. If you liked the video, please like, subscribe and share this video with your friends. Stay tuned for the next video.